Morning.
Morning.
I wore my overalls just to aggravate Mike Beasley. I'm hoping he sees this at some point in time.
Oh, he will.
Ugly. I got to tell y'all something. Well, let me introduce myself. So my name's Leon. My wife right there is Melinda. She is definitely the better half. I'm married up. All you got to do is look at her and look at me. Amen. It really wasn't that funny, but okay. So I just moved back to North Carolina. I'm from North Carolina, but just moved back. I lived in Utah for 6 years. I actually came to Freedom when Freedom first started and moved to Mississippi and actually started, my wife and I planted Freedom Bible Church in Mississippi. Well, along the way, something happened in November of 2014, and there was dissension in the church. It was kind of like, you know, I'm on this side, I'm on that side. I lost my focus. I resigned from the church, and I'm here to tell you this morning, I walked away, and I was miserable. And I just want you to know this morning, God's given me a message. And when I tell you what I'm getting ready to tell you, you're probably going to be like, why in the world is this man standing in the pulpit preaching this morning? Because on June 27th of this year, I walked out of my house in Bostic, North Carolina. Anybody ever heard of Bostic?
Yep.
I am amazed. I've never heard of anybody that heard of Bostic, North Carolina. They have to pipe sunshine where I live, and they don't come pick your trash up. You got to take it yourself. So I walked out of my house on June 27th, and I was cursing God. Please forgive me, but I'm just being real this morning, okay? Can we still be real at Freedom Bible Church?
Yes, sir. Woo!
I walked out of the house, and I said, F you, God. Leave me the F alone. I don't know why anybody prays to you. You don't answer prayers. You don't care about nobody. Just leave me alone.
Said that.
Anybody ever been there?
We all have.
Thank you. I was afraid y'all was going to be act all holy this morning.
Why did you get your attention?
But I got to tell you, that's a long story, brother. I was not at peace with myself and with the Lord for a long time. I didn't lose my faith. I still had my faith, but I was just angry. Man, I was mad at the world. I looked around. I was trying somebody to look at me wrong. I got some shirts I'm going to put on this morning to show you. I used to wear shirts around that says, give violence a chance. I got another shirt that says, stand back. I don't like people. I was mad. Anybody here that listens to heavy metal besides me and David? I was going to play, you know, after the music, if I'd have known all this, you know, I've been gone for a while. I'd have played a heavy metal song to drive home the point of the message this morning, but I'm just going to prove to you that God is speaking to me in amazing ways that you would never believe right now in my Christian walk. I was saved December 22nd, 1996, and since June 27th, the Lord has been speaking to me in amazing ways, and I'm going to prove it. God has been speaking to me through contemporary Christian music.
Oh, wow.
I know, Christy, that's amazing, isn't it?
Yeah.
Because I don't normally listen to Kayla. I'm more of a, I just know Jesus is the way type person, you know, with disciple. But I want to tell you this morning, man, that God is doing a miraculous work in my life, and I thank Him for it. I'm at peace for the first time in a long time. Amen? Yeah. I'm going to read some lyrics for you, and then we're going to play a video because it really is crazy how the Lord has just been using different songs to speak to me. I got in my car. I usually only listen to liquid metal. I have Sirius XM, and I like double bass, growling, screaming. I'm 56 years old. I was told when I was 16, when you grow up, you'll stop listening to that. Well, it's 40 years later, people, and I'm still in. And I love it just as much today as I did then. But listen to these lyrics from a disciple song. It's a new song by a disciple called Enemy. It says, I only have nightmares while my eyes are open, and I break my head against the wall. You reprimand, I say, think about what you've done, checking in like a poison you have become. I can't stop hating myself, can't stop enslaving myself. My world isn't burning, I only have nightmares while my eyes are open, and the worst has always been me. The worst has always been me. Of all my enemies, the worst has always been me. And this is what happened to me on June 27, brother. These lyrics say, I don't mean to scare you, darling, hanging off the edge, but I have fallen so far, I finally scared myself. I really prayed I wouldn't cry this morning, but you know, my heart has been so hard, and I haven't been receptive to anything that the Lord's been trying to tell me. And I finally am. But I want you to know, when I left the house on June 27th, I was mad as hell. And when I came back in the house, hell was mad. Amen. I left just a disgruntled, hateful, angry Christian. I got news for you. They're out there, people. I was one of them. When I came back in the house, I was a changed man. You say, really? Oh, yeah, I'm telling you, folks. It really happened. Because I'm just going to tell you, I thought about it like this. In Matthew chapter 4, when Satan was tempting Jesus, here's what Jesus did. We can't do it on our own. Amen? We don't have enough within us to resist the devil. It has to be through God's word. And I thought about it as I was reading that in Matthew 4. And in verse 11, after it was all over, after Jesus had been tempted, in verse 11 it says, and the angels ministered to Jesus. I'm here to tell you. Woo! When, anybody like Ric Flair?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Man, I'm going to tell you what. I was doing a Ric Flair outside. I was sitting on an old log in the middle of the woods, and angels came and ministered to me like never before. And I said, Jesus, where have you been? He said, I've been here the whole time, brother. He never left me. I was the one running away from him. Amen? But I want you to know, I want you to watch this song, and then we're going to get into the message. But this song has really been speaking to me because this is where I was at. I literally was praying June 27th, God, kill me. God, just kill me. That's how bad and how demented I was. Listen to this song, and we'll get into the message.
Truth be told, the truth
A Zach Williams song, and it's probably been out for a long time. I haven't watched anything or listened to anything Christian because I didn't want to hear it. And I was watching this video one day this week, and it was a Zach Williams song. There, he was singing it from prison, and where they did a concert. And it just really struck me, and the Lord spoke to me, and he said, "You're no longer a slave to sin. You're a child of God." Man, I thank God this morning that I am no longer a slave to sin, because I was trying to go back to all that garbage that I was doing before I met Christ in 96. And I'm here to tell you this morning, it don't work. Brothers and sisters, you want to be miserable? Go on back to where you were. And I'm just going to tell you, you're going to be ending up like me. So this morning, before I get started, there's one of my shirts I was wearing. Give violence a chance. Here's another shirt I've been wearing. I wore them all the time. Stand back. I don't like people. Can you imagine what people thought when I'm walking around with these kind of shirts on? They're like, this man's going to eat my children or something. All right, now, does anybody here remember when Freedom Biker Church sold knives?
Yes.
Has anybody got a knife? Can I borrow it? So I got to tell you a funny story. My daughter, she's in college. It's her senior year in Utah. We just took her back this week. She has a Freedom Biker Church knife in her room, and it's on her nightstand beside her bed. And all her roommates call it the Holy Shaker. She still got her Freedom Biker Church thing. So I'm going to tell you right now, here's what we're going to do, because I'm not wearing these anymore. It's not who I am anymore. Some of you probably like, you picking up, you should have pulled that on your own without a knife. Bikers always got to be tough. Here, buddy. Know how to close that thing. So if you have your Bibles this morning, turn to the book of James, which, oh, the irony, because James is my favorite book in the Bible. James chapter 1, verses 19 through 20. I'm going to read these verses, and then I'm going to tell you a story. I'm going to tell you, God, if you don't think He has a sense of humor, you're not paying attention. Amen?
Amen. Oh, me.
Listen to this. James chapter 1, verses 19 through 20. I use the King James. I like it because it challenges me. Whatever satanic version you use is totally up to you. That was a joke. Everybody relax. But anyway. Wherefore, my beloved brethren, let every man be swift to hear, slow to speak, and slow to wrath. For the wrath of man worketh not the righteousness of God. Really think about that, okay? Because I'm going to tell you, my wife, if she's honest, she will tell you that a lot of times it got to the point to where she was like, she would cringe when I would open my mouth. Because when you're angry and you're not walking with the Lord, you want to make sure everybody knows what you're thinking. Right? Whatever it is, I'm going to make sure I let you know I don't agree with that, bro. You're an idiot. God's still working on me because I have to be careful because a lot of times my first response is, well, that's dumb, that's stupid. I'm trying not to look at my wife because I know she's over there going, amen.
No doubt.
That was uncalled for. So we took our daughter back to Utah this week, and I was like, okay, Lord, I need some sermon illustrations, you know? I need some illustrations about all the anger going on in the world. Well, God said, don't worry about it. I'm going to put it right in front of your face. So we're at Salt Lake City Airport, and we're coming home on Thursday. It was Thursday, wasn't it, this week? This lady, Karen, anybody ever met a Karen? Oh, yeah. Karen was at the Salt Lake City Airport, y'all. I had my mask down drinking a coffee. She didn't like that. She said, and I think I was on my computer, and she said, are you on this flight? I looked up, I said, yes, ma'am. She said, do you have a mask? I said, yes, ma'am. And I'm like, okay, Lord, I promise I'm not gonna kill her. So I'm just gonna tell y'all right now, the Lord has been testing me all week. Does he not do that? I'm just gonna tell you right now, I told my wife, I said, I'm gonna preach on the lottery, because if I preach on the lottery, I'm gonna win. It's not in the Bible, by the way, so you can't do that. But this lady was literally, she was accosting everybody and anybody. We watched her, and one time I just had to look down. I had to quit looking. She was literally walking through our gate. We're at gate A17. She was going, oh. And she was just doing all this. She just kept on doing it. And my wife said, look, look, look. I said, baby, I can't. I literally, in my mind, y'all, I was saying this, and this true story, I said, thank you, Lord, that this didn't happen prior to June 27th. Because I probably would have told her a few choice words. Well, we get on the plane, and you know how it backs up because people don't know how to put luggage up and sit down, which that's a story for another day. And this man and this woman are stopped right in front of us, and the lady says, she doesn't know Jesus, so it's okay. The Lord really drove that home for me. She said, she doesn't know Jesus. She was talking to her husband. She wasn't talking to me. She said, she doesn't know Jesus, so it's okay. I pray that she didn't know Jesus, because if she knows Jesus and she was acting like that, she would have been my twin before June 27th. You know what I mean? It's kind of scary. So let me ask you something. Do you think God ever gets angry?
Yeah, look at us. That's why he gets angry.
I'm going to tell you, I know he had to be up there in heaven just going, Leon, Leon, Leon. My gosh, son, what are you doing? You know, I was really looking. I was like, you know, I did a study one time on how God kills so many people. And I'm going to be honest with you. My life, has anybody heard of the band Slipknot?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So my life has literally been the Slipknot song, People Equal Stinky. That is not the real name of the song, but anyway. That has been my mantra for a couple of years now. I mean, I would literally get in my car and be like, people hate my like, I hate people. They're so dumb. They're so mean. So if you really want to know, listen to some of these verses about how God gets angry. Psalm 7:11. God gets angry with the wicked every day. Deuteronomy 9:8. They provoked the Lord to wrath. Exodus 15:7 says God was burning with anger. Numbers 11:12 says God's anger was kindled against his people. Job 4:9 said the blast of his anger. Jeremiah 32:29, provoke me to anger. Matthew 21, remember what happened when Jesus came in and everything was going on wrong in the temple? He threw over the tables and everything else. And man, he was mad because they were not doing what they were supposed to do in the Lord's house. Romans 2:5, check this out. Because of your stubbornness and unrepentant heart, you are storing up wrath for yourself. Really think about that, okay? Paul is saying in Romans, because we are stubborn and because of our hard heart, that you and I are storing up wrath for ourselves. That's a real feel-good verse, isn't it? Mm. You know, really, a sermon should do four things. A sermon should really stretch your mind. It should kick your butt. It should inspire you, and it should challenge you to do better. Amen?
Amen. No doubt.
Because God's word will challenge you. If you read it, and I just want you to know this morning that I have been in the word every day. I have been having a Bible buffet. Amen? I'm just going to tell you, I really have. I have been laying in the bed at night asleep, and I cannot wait to wake up the next morning and read my Bible. I can't get enough of it right now. Because, folks, I want you to know, I didn't read my Bible for a couple of years. I went from pastoring a church to not even reading my Bible. I couldn't. I tried to open it several times, and I just shut it. I'd be like, Lord, I can't. I'm too mad. But I want you to know this morning that there's hope. Because I'm just going to tell you, folks, if God can do that for me, he can do that for you. Because I literally, just like Saul was arrested on the road to Damascus, Saul was going to persecute Christians, and Jesus said, what? Stop. We ain't doing that. That's literally what happened to me on June 27th. God said, enough is enough, Leon. You're destroying yourself. You're destroying everybody around you. And my wife and my daughter, she was home this summer. She's like, you know, you're really hard on yourself. It's not like you were out, you know, beating mom and doing cocaine and having affairs and all this stuff. And I'm like, I know, but I had really fallen a long way from where I was at. But I knew it was bad when, I don't remember if we were having lunch or breakfast or whatever, we're sitting around the table, something happened, and however I responded, and bless my wife, she said, "Woo, that ain't how you would have normally responded." And I went, wow, it was really bad, wasn't it? You know, the Bible has a lot to say about anger. We're going to get into that in a minute. But here's the first thing that you and I need to remember and never forget this. Anger distracts us from listening to God. Anger distracts you and I from listening to God. If you go into Proverbs, where Proverbs really compares and contrasts the foolish with the wise. Yeah, I've been slapped around by the Lord quite a bit over the last couple weeks. Listen to some of these verses. Proverbs 10:19 basically says, I'm gonna give you the redneck version from Alamance County. Shut up and listen. Go read it for yourself. Proverbs 14:17, quick tempered equals someone that's hated. I'm gonna tell you, I know people had to just hate to see me coming. I was thinking about this, and y'all pray for me. We got some friends in where we live. We started hanging out with them. And I know the first time we went and ate dinner with them, they went, what in the world is wrong with this man? I was like, I hate this. Does anybody think that's fun to be around?
No.
That ain't no fun to be around, is it? That's all somebody's doing. I hate this. I hate that. That's stupid. That's dumb. Everything's stupid and dumb. Ain't nobody get along in the world today. That's why me and my friend in Utah, we were talking about, she said something about politics. I said, I ain't talking about politics. I hate politics. Politics don't do nothing but divide us as a country. It divides families. Don't even get me started. I don't care who you like. I want to talk about Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Look at Proverbs 17:27. Talks about a calm spirit equals a man of understanding. Ecclesiastes 7:9 says, an angry man equals a fool. That's really what we are. Right? Listen to some of these quotes I found. These are pretty cool. If I can find them. I like to read quotes. Anybody like to look up quotes from people? Billy Graham. Hot heads and cold hearts never solved anything. Hot heads and cold hearts never solved anything. Man, this is a good one right here by C.S. Lewis. To be a Christian means to forgive the inexcusable because God has forgiven the inexcusable in you. You know, you ever get read the Bible, sometimes you go, I really don't like that. I know that. Makes me mad. Martin Luther King, I have decided to stick with love. Hate is too great a burden to bear. Ooh. Another MLK quote. Check this out. And this is what we're doing in our country today, whether you believe it or not. I don't care if I leave here. I'm going back home 4 hours away. Send your email to mike.beasley@freedombikerchurch.com.
Preacher@freedombikerchurch.
Huh?
It's preacher at
freedombikerchurch.com. My name is Bob Smith. You can complain about Bob preaching here. Let's check this out. Returning hate for hate multiplies hate. Adding deeper darkness to a night already devoid of stars. Darkness cannot drive out darkness. Only light can do that. Hate cannot drive out hate. Only love can do that. Who's the light of the world?
Jesus
Christ. Amen? Amen? What does the two greatest commandments say? Love God and love
thy neighbor.
It ain't people equal stinky. It's love God and love people. You know, that'd be a great name for a church. The church of love God, love people. It's kind of easy to say, but it's hard to do, ain't it? Amen? Because I'm going to tell you right now, that lady at the airport, my first inclination was to rip her head off and teach her a lesson. But then the Holy Spirit spoke to me to see, this is what happens. Sorry, I have to keep white, but fat people sweat. I got the COVID-19 last June, and I gained 21 pounds. I really did. I gained 21 pounds from COVID-19. But I'm going to try to get that all starting tomorrow. I'm going to Redneck Barbecue after church. I might get 3 entrees since I'm starting tomorrow. Listen to this last one. This is a good one, too. Hold on. This is Charles Spurgeon. Do not say, I cannot help having a bad temper. That's bull. Friend, you must help it. Pray to God to help you. Overcome it at once, for either you must kill it or it will kill you. You cannot carry a bad temper into heaven.
That's right.
We ain't got the mic to drop. That's a mic drop right there. Here's something that the Lord has shown me with my anger. And I'm going to be honest with you. I am an angry person. I'm a violent person by nature. Like, I grew up, I loved to fight. I don't know, it was just fun. Me and my friends, we'd fight each other, we'd be bleeding, and we'd hug each other. Man, I love you, I'm sorry. We were stupid. You know, if you ain't never grew up like that, then you're not going to understand that. But it's just kind of dumb, really, when you stop to think about it. And, you know, God expects us to forgive other people the way that He's forgiven us. How many people have a problem with that? Well, I'm going to tell you right now, I forgive them, but I have never forgiven them. I don't really think that's biblical. I don't know about y'all. But everything that I've read, that don't line with the scripture. Amen? You know, here's one verse of scripture that I really don't like. And after I've been to heaven 2,000 or 3,000 years, I'm going to ask Jesus about it. Don't forgive 7 times, but 7 times 70. That hurts, don't it? Y'all, I was so delusional. My wife can tell you. I know she had to be sitting over there going, oh my gosh, Lord, help this crazy man. The day after Mother's Day, I called my mom and I blessed her out. Sure did, the day after Mother's Day. The day after, I was nice. I thought I was being nice. I didn't do it on Mother's Day. That was the old forgive, but don't forget. So my grandmother raised me. And I called my mom up and I said, let me tell you something. You drop my blankety blank off and you go do your thing, come pick me up. I mean, I was just going off the deep end. She said, I knew you ain't never forgive me for that. And I'm like, yeah, bye. Man, I'm just going to tell you. It really don't matter what someone's done to you if we look at it through a lens of what Jesus has done for us. Amen? I know that's hard to do. It's hard for me, but God expects us to do that. Can I just tell y'all, I have been really nervous. I thought I was going to throw up before I got up here to preach. I told my brother over there, I was like, man, I am really nervous. And you know, let me tell you this, because this is really cool. You know, the enemy comes to steal, kill, and destroy. Amen? So I'm preparing to preach this message. Mike asked me to preach, and I'm like, you? When Mike called me, he's like, by the way, let me remind me to tell y'all a story about the preacher. I don't really like it. Mike called me up. He goes, hey, brother, I'm going on vacation. And Lord really laid on my heart for you to preach. I said, you do realize how I've been living, right? He said, well, yeah, brother. So Mike and Charlene came and visited me and Melinda, I don't know, 2 months ago, 3 months ago, whatever how long it's been. And he left, and he said, well, I knew Leon still had bitterness in his heart. And we've been going through Oswald Chambers and his utmost for his highest and all this other stuff. And just, I've just been sharing with Mike how God's just really just working on me and just showing me things where I've made mistakes in the past, you know, whether it was at Freedom in Mississippi or just in life in general. And the devil's really been on me. The devil's really been going, you have no business preaching God's word. You've been living like hell. Why are you going to be preaching his word? I want you to know this morning, I woke up, I went and told my wife, I've been praying. I said, God, give me a sign that I'm okay. Because I take this very serious, sharing God's word. It's not nothing to play around with. I opened up my Bible this morning. I just literally, y'all, I did this. I went downstairs at Hampton Inn. I opened my Bible up. And it opened up to Peter denying Christ. Not once, not twice, but 3 times. But what happened after that? Peter was leading the charge right after denying Christ 3 times. Amen? Because I'm just going to tell you, man, God instantly did a work in my life on June 27th that's just hard to explain. And I'm thanking for that this morning, man. Isn't it so cool how God works? Well, let me tell you why I don't like your preaching. Christy, can we stop that real quick?
No, this is getting good.
So, we had some relatives at the house. Was it last week? I don't know. My weeks are running together. It's been increasing. And they talking about they going to this church where the kids and grandkids go and this, that, and the other. And I'm like, they do realize it. You know, that's an arrogant jerk or preacher that's there, in my opinion. And I was talking to Mike after that. I said, can you believe that these people
are going to go to this church just because their kids and grandkids go there, and they know the preacher's an arrogant jerk. They've already left this church one time. He goes, Mike said, you ever thought that God might be putting them there because that's what that preacher needs? And I went, you see why I don't like him? That stuff is just, it's too funny. You can't make that stuff up. So we're going through this Oswald Chambers study. And by the way, Mike told me I had all the time I wanted. I ain't preached in a couple years. So I'm probably going to get done about 4 o'clock today. If you need to leave, just get up and leave. I know, you know, you're not spiritually mature. Just kidding. But me and Dave and Pam went to dinner last night, and we were talking about Oswald Chambers and just how he just like takes a 2x4 and just knocks you upside the head. I was reading something in Oswald Chambers this week, and I text Mike Beasley, and I said, you know, I know this guy's been dead for a long time, but I don't really like him. Listen to this from Oswald Chambers. Never look for righteousness in others, but never cease to be righteous. That's a hard one, ain't it? But you see, I pastored the church, Freedom Biker Church in Mississippi, for 8 years. It was probably 7 years and 9 months, the best time of my life, and I let the last 3 months just completely derail me. Because I would counsel with people, and I'd be like, get your eyes off man, get your eyes on God. And then here I am, I'm doing the same thing, and I'm preaching and counseling people, and I'm doing it. If it's one thing that the Lord has shown me that I want to encourage you, is pay no attention to what anybody else is doing. Focus on your relationship with the Lord, and everything else will work out.
Amen.
When everything is falling apart around you, focus on Him. And I'm here to tell you this morning, folks, if you don't believe in God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, I am standing before you this morning proof. Okay? Because before June 27th, I was angry, bitter, hate, filled with hate. And you know, it's kind of funny because I literally have been going out just looking for somebody to punch. And I got my gun with me everywhere I go. I'm like, Lord, please let me kill somebody today. Just please. I know self-defense, defending somebody else, just let me unload. But that don't do us any good, does it? I literally went from that mindset to where I'm at today. And it is miraculous. Instantly changed. Man, I'm here to tell you this morning that the Lord can instantly change you no matter what you're going through. And here's something else that the Lord has shown me. All my pain, all my failures, all my disappointments, everything that has happened to me is preparing me for what God has for me next. I feel like I'm kind of like where Job was. You know, Job's wife said, curse God and die. He's like, you foolish woman. Shut your mouth. Now that's kind of redneck version. But God has really just shown me so many things that I was just so blind to because I wasn't in His Word. I wasn't praying. I prayed, God, let me kill somebody. I think He's paying any attention to that silliness. But here's the irony. Every single time I wanted to hurt somebody, my wife was with me. She wasn't in this car. She wasn't in the room. Because I don't want to embarrass my wife. Or my daughter was with me. Literally, y'all, if thought bubbles would have went up, it would have scared everybody in the car or whoever was walking down the sidewalk. Because God, in His infinite wisdom, knew that I wouldn't do anything to embarrass her or my children. So every situation happened and somebody was with me. I really just looked back on that and went, wow. That just shows you how sovereign God is. Amen? So, let me ask you this. You either have two things on your lips. You either have profane or you have praise. There is no in between. God's word says you either serve me or you serve the devil. A lot of us, we think that there's an in-between, but it's not. You're either serving him or you're serving the devil. I'm just going to tell you right now, the devil has been happy with me. Because he's like, yeah, buddy, I got Leon derailed. Yes, sir. Now, I'm going into restaurants, I'm walking around, I'm actually smiling at people again. I'm like, how you doing, brother? Jesus loves you, amen. Whereas before, I was like, Jesus hates you and I'm going to kill you. It's the truth, though, isn't it? Man, God did a miraculous work in me. If there's one thing that you and I need to remember, you and I are going to be remembered by how we treat other people. Really let that sink in. Listen to this. Proverbs 17:28 says, keep silent and be esteemed as a man or woman of understanding. Proverbs 16:32, be slow to anger is better than the mighty who can overtake a city. Proverbs 15:18, wrathful man stirs strife. That's what I was doing, buddy. I'm going to tell you what, I had me a big old thing. I was stirring it. Come on, girl. Proverbs 26:21 says, an angry man kindles fires. Man, I had firewood, I had lighter fluid, I'm like, huh? Bro, I did, I had some gasoline. And let me tell you something, men. All you men that have beards, I'm here to help you this morning, okay? When you're angry, and you got your burn pit at your house, and you throw gas on it, and you burn about 2-3 inches of your beard, it's not a good day. I had to come in the house and I told my wife, I said, she said, my gosh, what happened to you? Because I burned my beard in the burn pile. Because I was out there, I was throwing everything on that son of a gun, throwing gas, fire. Next thing I know, my beard's going. I ain't went and got my beard trimmed for y'all. What day did I get my beard trimmed this week? Because this thing is wild. It was like hair was going out here. So it's all shaped up for y'all. Does it look good? It's my gray highlights in here. I said, oh, Lord. We're getting close to the end, and I don't know what time it is. I don't care. I ain't preaching so long. I'm so happy right now. I can't, like a pig in slop. Turn to Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians 4, verses 30 through 32. Listen to the words of Paul. And grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. Listen, I'm just going to tell you right now, it does not matter. If I would have died prior to June 27th, I'm still going to heaven. I'm a child of God. Do you hear what I'm telling you this morning? My salvation is assured by one thing and one thing only. That's the blood of Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen. Listen, I was listening to a guy. No, it wasn't. I was listening, talking to a pastor friend of mine who just resigned from the church. Let me tell you something, folks. Pray for pastors. They're under attack. Yep. Amen? Amen? If you do anything for the Lord, you're going to come under attack. Okay? I can promise you that right now. You don't have to be a pastor. You can do anything. If you love Jesus and you're trying to impact the community and impact others, get ready, folks, because it's coming. I was talking to a pastor friend of mine, and me and him have been talking to each other, and we've both been going through a really difficult time. He just resigned within the last 6 months, I think it's been. He says, you know, Leon, I want to share something with you. He said, my son shared this with me. He said, it really helped me, and I'm praying it's going to help you. This is prior to June 27th. So God's been trying to work. I've just been stubborn and not wanting to listen. He said, now really pay attention to this. God does not love you or I any more or any less because of our performance. Amen, bro. God does not love you or I any more or any less because of our performance. I'm going to tell you, that's the reason we go to Pentecostal and kick your shoes off and run around and scream and yell. Amen? And then he said, what really got me, Leon, he said, was God is always looking to renew and restore our spirit. Whew. Man, that's good. If we will just be willing and open our heart and be receptive, he's ready to restore us and renew us. Man, it can happen. Listen, it don't have to be months and years. It's like that. If you told me, listen, I got PTSD with church. Can I just be real? I went and pastored, after I resigned from Freedom, I had this brilliant idea that I was going to pastor a traditional church. I know y'all thinking, that's really funny, bro. So I was trying to get right with the Lord and get back to where I was. And I went and pastored this church. It lasted a few months. I wasn't ready. You hear me? A few months. I just got mad and quit. I said, y'all don't care about lost people? Peace out. I'm gone. Moved back to Utah. Stayed in North Carolina less than a year. People were laughing their tails off. Oh my gosh, Leon, he done come back to North Carolina. Ain't even lasted a year. I left. I went in, and here's where you know that things are going wrong. I went in, talked to the leaders of the church, and I'm like, I see we got a bunch of money in the bank. What do y'all think about us using about a third of that to help the community? You'd have thought Lucifer had stood up in the deacon meeting. But I handled it wrong. I'm being real with you. I handled it wrong. I should have handled it a totally different way, and I didn't. Listen to what Paul says. She goes forward. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice, and be ye kind to one another. That's a novel idea, ain't it? How about we just be nice to each other? My wife's got on a shirt right now that says, be a nice human. For goodness sakes, can we just be nice? Tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake hath forgiven you. I don't know why, but it really drove it home to me this week. It says, even as God. God's saying, for Christ's sake, people, get along with one another. We got families that won't speak to each other because one's a Democrat and one's a Republican. I'm telling you right now, I don't care if y'all ever invite me back again. It's ungodly. Mm-hmm. Made some friends on that one, didn't I? Let me tell you something. The gospel of Jesus Christ is more than important than anything. God's word says he uses evil people to fulfill his will. Okay? There's evil people in both parties. Don't fool yourself. People in here going, is he done? I'm getting ready to leave. So when somebody offends you, should you hold a grudge or just let it ride? Y'all being all holy. No, Darren did well. Somebody here y'all mad at right now. So it's real cool to listen to a preacher get up here and talk, but what does Jesus say about it? Well, let's look. Ecclesiastes. Look at Mark 11, verses 25 through 26, and we're going to be about done. Mark 11, 25 through 26. I'm going to give you the redneck version. Forgive or don't be forgiven. Mm. How's that sit with you? Put that in your pipe and smoke it. That sounds real good, don't it? Mm. Forgive or don't be forgiven. You don't believe me? Let's look at it. Mark chapter 11. Let's go there. You know, it's been funny. I've been reading my Bible, and it took me a couple weeks to get back to knowing where stuff was at in the Bible. I haven't been out of it so long. Listen to this. These are the words of Jesus Christ. And when you stand praying, forgive if you have aught or a problem against any, that your Father also which is in heaven may forgive you your trespasses. But, you know, if there's one thing I have noticed, and I told my wife, there is a whole lot of if and buts in the Bible. It really is. A whole lot of if and buts. But if you do not forgive, neither will your Father which is in heaven forgive you your trespasses. Hey, I didn't say that. Don't get mad at me. Take it up with the senior pastor, which is Jesus. Amen? Last thing, and then I'm going to let y'all come up. Anybody ever read the, I was picking earlier about the King James. I like a lot of different translations. Has anybody ever looked at the Message translation? Mm-hmm. They say stuff really cool sometimes. So I'm going to close with this. Look in your Bibles. Look at Hebrews chapter 4, verses 14 through 16. Listen to the Message translation. It's really neat. Now that we know what we have, Jesus, this great high priest with ready access to God, let's not let it slip through our fingers. We don't have a high priest who is out of touch with our reality. He's been through weaknesses and testing, experienced it all but sin. So let's walk right up to him and get what he has so ready to give, take the mercy and accept the help. People, God is my witness. Don't go where I've been. It's miserable. It is not a good place to be. If you are truly God's child and you've accepted him as your Lord and Savior and you're not living for him, you're going to be miserable. Been there, done that. I told Mike, I said, I got that t-shirt 9 times, I think. If you are God's child, I want to ask you this morning before the band comes up. Whatever is going on in your life, we all struggle with something. Right? There's something that each person struggles with. It's different than the other person. Mine was anger. Yours might be gossip. Yours might be pornography. It could be anything. Just put it in there. But we all struggle with something. And I want you to know this morning that I have a peace that goes beyond all understanding of man because of what I have done by turning back to the Lord. He has restored me. He has renewed me. And I want to encourage you this morning. You can do this. You can run around with your sin that you've got hidden. And you can hold on to it. And you can carry it with you everywhere you go. It doesn't matter. Where you're home, work, relatives, where you can hold on to it. Just like I did. I held on to my anger. I like my anger. Or you can let it go and give it to the Lord. Don't pay attention to what anybody's doing in this room this morning. Ben, can y'all come on up? Pay no attention to what anything is going on. You don't have to come up here. You can do it from your seat. But I just want to encourage you this morning. Whatever you are struggling with, no matter how small or no matter how big it might be this morning, I'm here to tell you right now, it's easy. I tell everyone, it's easy to be angry. But it's hard to love when some people are unlovable. Amen? So, as they get ready to play, I would just say, please, please, open your heart and let Jesus in and let go of whatever it is that you're struggling with. Because whatever it is, he can take it from you. And I'm telling you, he can take it from you. Just like that. I love y'all. Thank you for allowing me to be here this morning.